Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Build Value by Choice. I am your host, Nana Bonsu, President and CEO of Infinite Horizons Incorporated. People normally come to Infinite Horizons Incorporated because of our proven systems for increasing long-term profits and long-term value. They also come to us because of our insights into an industry knowledge, as well as our personalized advice. This week, we are going to be talking about all things HR. And I would like to remind our listeners to not forget to subscribe, download on the podcast, various podcast platforms that you may be listening on. You may also subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you do want to participate in the conversation, you may do so on the Facebook community page. Just search for Build Value by Choice. Just a quick announcement I want to share with everybody that we actually, on September 22nd, will be our one-year anniversary. So we have a lot of good things planned. We're going to be giving away gifts. So look out for that. Again, September 22nd, we're planning on relaunching this show. And in order to do that, we are going to be giving away some nice prizes. So just tune into that. Also, if you'd like to see a free ebook on how you may grow your business, especially if you've hit a plateau, I have a free ebook for people who are especially in the services industry. You just go to https://bit.ly/productize/z ebook one word to download it. Now on to today's guest. My guest today is Rick Maher. Rick is the CEO of Turning Point HCM. Turning Point HCM is focused on helping small businesses deal with HR. And he actually built this business from the ground up and recently acquired another one to build as well. His motto in life is family first and growth is the only option. He strives every day not only to fulfill and to exceed his company's mission of releasing the pressure valve that builds in business owners whenever legal or day-to-day human issues pop up. Welcome to the show, Rick.
Thank you, Nana. Thank you for having me. Excited to be here.
Wonderful. We're excited to have you as well. I wanted to kick off by, I always like to get a sense of the person's background. Just what is your background and what inspired you to start Turning Point HCM?
So my background, I grew up, if you will, after graduating college and kind of starting my career, was in the employee benefits space. And I spent about 18 years in that space, with my last role being the national practice leader for a Goldman Sachs Capital Loan Partner company, and really working with very large businesses and complex businesses and dealing with their employee benefits. And in that space, I was typically dealing with the HR departments of these big organizations. And what I started to realize was that smaller organizations, and I'll define what they look like in a moment, smaller organizations did not have this level of resource, this HR team, this, you know, this budget to go and do the things that the business needed to make sure that their employees were, you know, to attract good employees, retain good employees, engage employees, and all those kinds of things. And I started to look at the smaller businesses, and let's call them first or second generation family businesses with a handful to several hundred employees. And typically those businesses are doing around $1 million to $50 million in revenue. Those businesses didn't have or weren't large enough or you know, weren't sophisticated enough to have that level of HR support within their organization. And therefore, those business leaders may be making mistakes when they were purchasing, really, in this case, benefits, right? So really the motivation was I saw a hole in the marketplace. And all of those businesses that I just described, those first or second generation family businesses out there, and I thought to myself, I can marry if I can find the right team members, I can marry that big company HR support, but on a fractional basis, meaning right resource, right time, right price. So that was really the motivation that I had, which was to look at all these small businesses across the country and say, how can they too should have that level of resource, but how does someone get it to them? As I mentioned earlier, right resource, right time, right price. And that was the motivation for starting this business. And that was in 2010 when I started this business. And just quickly, since that time, we've worked with over 2,000 businesses across the country in 65 different industries, and we've been in every state except for Alaska at this point. So hopefully you have some listeners in Alaska, and maybe that'll translate into how we go from here. So that was really the motivation.
Well, that's great. That's congratulations. That's an awesome journey. You know, in 12 years' time, you already raised your footprint to 49 states. That's pretty impressive. What are some of the biggest challenges you face along the way as you build the company?
I think the biggest challenge that I faced along the way was that when I started my business, and as you mentioned, I started from the ground up. I had no business owner experience. I'd never been in a true leadership role, you know, of an organization. And the biggest mistake that I made early on was believing that all we had to do, all I had to do at that point in time, was to sell business, get clients coming in the door, and everything else will just kind of take care of itself. And that was a tremendous mistake that I made in not understanding at all levels, to simplify it, that people, process, and procedure are the keys, and significant keys, to growing a business. I was just purely focused on that top line and thought that that wallpaper could cover up any blemishes on the wall. And that was a big mistake that I made. And I learned the hard way. Let's start there.
So how do you go about bringing people into your company?
Yeah. There was a real, some real learning curves. And I guess the first part of it was that I looked at the businesses that I was serving, right? And the businesses that we were getting into. And I started to look at all those businesses, and they had common problems, right? And the problems were that because they didn't have that professional HR support, they kept bumping into four basic problems. The first one was compliance stuff, right? So every day there's some new law, rule, or regulation that the business owner, let's focus on HR for this for the next few moments, the business owner has to deal with. The second bucket of problems that they all struggled with were employee issues. Everything from hiring properly to firing properly, and why can't someone get to work on time, and why is someone else harassing everybody in the business? The third problem that I saw they all had was policies and procedures. So all the things that would allow the business to scale and grow profitably and allow the business owner to achieve their goals, which was typically some level of happiness and freedom, right? So think of things, handbooks, job descriptions, and performance management. And the fourth thing that we were solving for these clients is the strategic side, or the organizational development. How to get the right people on the team in the right seats and those things, right? So as I looked at my clients and had all those problems, I started to realize, this was, you know, 2011, 2012, a couple of years into this thing, I had those same problems. I was guilty of the problems that I was trying to solve for my clients. So it became very internally focused on what I needed to do to grow my business to where we are now. We have, you know, 15 team members and serving all those businesses across the country. It became, how do I do that? And what steps do I need to take in order to get to the place that I need to be so that I can grow? I can deliver on the promises that I made to my wife and family, which was I was going to be there a little bit, not just working all the time. So there was this tipping point, if you will, this turning point, where I had to decide what I wanted to be. Did I just want to own my job, which was just to go sell business and run around like a crazed person all the time? Or was I going to build a business that was going to have a legacy and have and allow me to do the things that I really wanted to do in my life? As you mentioned, family first, and growth is the only option. So, 2012, 2013, as I started to recognize this, recognize the mistakes I was making, it became essential for me to bring on, as the first place, not a sales rep, not someone to replace me, but someone who is purely operational, who can build the people, process, and procedure going forward.
That's an interesting kind of journey. And it brings up a question, kind of an interesting observation, because you had mentioned that you had to go from being an entrepreneur to actually running a disciplined business operation. There's a lesson in there for entrepreneurs and aspiring entrepreneurs, right? Which is that being an entrepreneur, yeah, it's nice and dandy, but you can go from like one idea to the next, versus being focused and disciplined and having somebody actually run the business or doing the operations. And then maybe you as a business owner can focus on the growth side of it, the vision side of it, the networking side of it, and among other things. What would your advice be for the other entrepreneurs or even business owners who've been in operation for a little bit of time, but everything goes through them, and therefore they're having some scalability issues as a result?
Yeah, I think the first thing was, real self-introspective of why did someone leave that cushy job with benefits and time off and a paycheck every 2 weeks? Why did they do it, right? I think that's really the first question that has to be asked of themselves, because the why is going to be what drives the how and the what, right? So for instance, for me, the why was, I had at that point when I started the business, I had three young sons, and I wanted to be a part of the, the Little League and the after school activities and all that kind of stuff. So there was no way that I can do what I wanted to do the way I was running my business, right? There's no way. So the why was, why did I do this? Because I wanted to, family first, as you recall, I wanted to be their family first. So there was just no way that I could do this. So I think for each business owner, they have to understand their why, right? Then that drives the how, right? So we really, as I started to recognize this and bring on that first operational person who's still with me today, it became important for me to start to say, okay, if I want to do this, what has to happen at work, right? And what we really started to change was really define the roles. And what I did was I stepped aside from owning the business and I became an employee of the business. And what do I mean by that? I gave myself a job description, visionary. My job was to create ideas and say, how are we going? Remember why, how, and then the COO does the what, right? The how is, how are we going to get to this place where I have a business that I can step away from, that can be a legacy or whatever it is that each business owner wants? And the only way that I can get there was to envision what this thing was going to look like 8, 10, 12, 15 years from now. And the only way that I, as the owner of the business, could implement that vision was to have someone who understands how to build people, process, and procedure. So we've created this symbiotic relationship between the vision, the what, and then the how gets kind of talked about, right? That's the conversation each week. And then the what, and then the how gets implemented by the COO. So we really, even as a small, basically two-person company, bifurcated the job description and took me away from thinking like an owner and more thinking like a position in the company. And the company could not succeed if we didn't have, in an initial point, these two positions that operated equally, even though I was the owner.
Interesting. That's an interesting kind of take, because I'm thinking that if you wanted to be the independent owner, because one of the things, obviously, like, even I think Michael Gerber even kind of mentions this, where you have like the roles, the boxes, and a lot of times the owner finds that they're like, they're operating schizophrenically without even realizing it, because they're like wearing multiple hats. And then that's when you realize you came up with a plan to transition, who's going to do marketing, who's going to do finance. And obviously you had a CEO to handle the operational side of things. But you actually had to figure out what your role was going to be and actually make sure that it was documented, which is actually...
I think just to touch on the Michael Gerber book, because that was an inspirational book for me in a lot of different ways as a lot of business owners. Right. And what my motivation was, so my motivation, this may sound funny, is laziness. I didn't want to have to do anything, right? In the beginning, I felt I needed to, or I thought that's what the role was. But the more I realized that, I had to start pushing things off immediately, because the little things that I pushed off 10, 12 years ago was the beginning process of pushing off and managing to a team 12 years later. So that, let's call it laziness, was a pure motivator that I really didn't want to do everything. And it was just, you know, when you're there in the beginning, you don't know any better and the money's tight and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes you feel like you have to, and that's a part of it, but do you want to? And that was a motivator for me to kind of start to separate this thing into visionary, people, process, procedure.
Now that's great. Maybe we can, actually, I mean, I'm being just facetious here, but maybe you know, we can just make pretend for entrepreneurs who may be having a hard time let go of the reins. Maybe we can let them pretend or play the role of a lazy owner, just so they can kind of keep their hands off, like, you know, micromanagement, because that's one of the, because what you're touching on is kind of a mindset thing. I mean, it may have been unbeknownst to you at the time, but a lot of times what happens is business owners, especially if you're building it from the ground up, is it's their brainchild and they love what they do, but they want to be their own boss, right? So they're so, you know, start with why. They just wanted to, you know, what they consider to be freedom, wanted to be their own boss, but they're trading their 40 hour per week Christian job, right? To now they're working 60 plus hours a week, things of that sort. So they may not necessarily even want to operate a business, even though they want to somehow grow, but they don't want to let go of the reins because they love what they do. That's their life work. They won't know what purpose they have outside of that, you know, business.
I think to jump in on that, sorry to cut you off. I think what every business owner has to think about when they're doing it that way, right? The way I was doing it in the beginning, the way probably most of us did in the beginning, unless someone gave us a bunch of money and said, here, start a business, which didn't happen for me, is remember that day, right? And we all had this day, because I talked to a lot of business owners. I always ask them about this day. There's this day where they went to someone who's very important to them in their life, a spouse, a parent, a significant other, somebody. And they said, I have an idea and it's going to sound crazy. I'm going to leave my job. I'm going to start a business. And when I start this business, we're going to be richer than we ever were before. We're going to have more time off than we have ever done. And I'm going to work a lot less, right? There's that day. We all have it. We go, this is going to be great. And what we find very early on, we have no money. You know, we're working 1,000 hours a week. If there's 1,000 hours in a day, we're trying to work. And the cushiness and all the things that went along with a job that we left are now all gone, right? So for me, or maybe for younger, newer entrepreneurs that are jumping into this, we've all had that day. And think about if we're doing it wrong, right? How we're letting down that person that we said, trust me, this is going to be great. And that too was a motivator for me, because I couldn't do it that way anymore, because of, I was failing at everything I sold, in my case, my spouse, on what was going to be great about this. So to me, it was more of a personal pride thing. Like I can't let I can't let her down. I can't let my children down because I said I was going to do this. And now it's the opposite is happening.
Yeah, that's actually a very good point. A very good way to force people to like make a change. So I want to talk about some of the obstacles that people face when they're trying to build a great team of people. Because as you mentioned, part of being having a great business is having a great, building a great team of people. Obviously, first you got to be able to find people to hire. You got to be able to onboard them. You have to manage and train them and things of that sort. Could you talk about just this challenge of finding the right people to come into the business and how Turning Point helps in that aspect?
Yeah. So the first thing, and we do this literally every day with business owners now. I mean, the clients across the country, we're literally talking about recruiting and really building teams, the organizational development, whether that organization is one person going to two or it's 200 going to 400, right? It's kind of the same process. And really for the technical aspect of the process. But the first part of the process is what that entrepreneur has to think about is, why is it that they're hiring this person, right? So a lot of times they hire that first person and expect that that person is just going to think and act like they are, like they do, right? Unless they're have your same last name or your best friend from little high school or something along those lines, probably they're not, right? So what the business owner has to do first is, and most of them don't do this because this is not their skill set, right? I started a business because I was good at sales or accounting or, whatever it might be. And I am not trained in how to hire, how to build a job, how to build a position, how to put metrics around that. So what typically happens in the beginning is the first person, they say, I need an assistant, right? Or whatever. And someone, their next door neighbor goes, oh, my brother-in-law does that. I think you'll love him, right? Oh, great, great. So the brother-in-law comes on an interview and it goes like this. Oh, I see you went to such and such school. Oh, I have a friend that went to that school. Did you know him? Oh, yeah, I knew him. Oh, great. You know what? You seem like you'd be great at this job. So the interviewing process, they don't even know what they're looking for. They're looking, in many cases, for lack of a better term, they're looking for a friend. They're looking for someone they like, right? Most of the time that ends up failing. And they go, I can't find any good people. The reason they can't find good people is because they don't build a process around recruiting. They don't know what they're looking for. They don't know how to ask good questions. They don't know how to write good job ads, right? Job ads are a marketing piece. So there's a lot of things that go wrong in that. And what ends up happening is by the time you start onboarding people, now they don't have a good onboarding process. The onboarding process is, oh, great. Congratulations on your first day. There's your desk. There's your phone. Let me know if you have any questions. Sets the employees off on the wrong foot. So what I would kind of summarize all of that is hiring a good team member starts at the very basic level. What is it that you're looking for? What are they going to do? How are you going to judge them? Is it consistent, right? From your recruiting process to once they're here and how you're working with them. And then the final thing and the biggest thing, and I think this is the biggest problem for most small business owners, are you going to let them do their job? Or are you going to just say, do this, do that, do this, do that, do it my way, or it's the highway? And I think those are big problems for business owners. So building the process and walking them through that process on a step-by-step basis is how we help those clients. And we have a saying, it's kind of silly, and I'm sure a lot of people have heard this. If you think it's expensive hiring professionals, wait till you hire an amateur, right? And the amateur in this case is the owner of the business because they're amateurish when it comes to the recruiting, hiring, onboarding, training, leading process. And that mistake could be tremendous. So think about it. If you hire your first employee and it's a $50,000 a year salary, right? and you do it wrong, just think of these expenses. The first is the recruiting expense. As a business owner, I always put a $250 an hour price tag on the business, whether they make that money or not. It's their time, their vision, their this. So you got all that expense. Then you have the expense of the salary, right? So let's say it's 6 months into it. You paid them $25,000, and now you're like, this person's not that good. I got to get rid of them. You've paid them maybe some vacation time. Certainly, you've paid training time. You may have paid benefits time, right? You've paid taxes on their payroll. So that $25,000 in that first 6 months might be really $35,000 or $40,000. That's really expensive, right? That's amateur hiring, $40,000. Now, after 6 months, you say, let me get rid of this person. And you're going to do it again. $40,000, right? It becomes the amateur hiring process becomes super, super expensive, right? Because they don't really know what they're looking for. They haven't really done that. So I think from a way that we help employers is they have to build a proper process and procedure to find the right people. People, process, procedure. So that's really the first step in getting involved and in how we work with clients on that front.
That's great. Thanks for the sharing those things, those insights. Now, after they've come on board, now there's the onboarding process, right? Because part of the critical success factor for new employees is how well they are onboarded, and of course, any kind of training that's needed. Do you help with that as well? Or if not, what are your observations of how that's taking place?
Oh, absolutely. I think, when we work with a business owner and we give them this taste of freedom, right? I don't have to do the recruiting. I don't have to do this. And they start to see on the recruiting side what process and procedure does for them. They become addicted to that. And now they want that same process and procedure on the onboarding side, right? So there are a lot of things that we've done that builds the process, in some cases using automated technology. You can't go to step two until you do step one. Step one, sign the offer letter. Step two, fill out the application. Step three, the I-9, right? So in a lot of cases, we automate that so that it goes through. So even to the point, okay, here's your password. Here's IT's phone number to get your computer set up. Right. Every little detail that's done, the earlier that's done for the employee, the better they will perform. And it has to be congruent or aligned with everything that they've experienced to this point, right? So if you have a really good and solid recruiting process, that sets the tone for that employee. Now, everything after that has to follow along and be done the same way. So if you have a really haphazard recruiting process, you're probably going to find people that like haphazardness, right? So if you have people that have haphazardness during the recruiting process, when they come on board, and now if you try to give them rules and regulations, they're going to go, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's very different than the experience I've had so far. And they're already off on the wrong foot. So if you're going to have a good, solid process and procedure up front, you got to have a great onboarding process where we help with that as well. All kinds of training and steps and so on and so forth and automation. Because if you don't, you're going to lose that person in all likelihood pretty easily. Now, if you say, hey, I'm going to have no process on the front end, I'm going to have no process on the front end and no, to keep it congruent or aligned, I'm going to have no process in onboarding. Probably you're not going to have, the employee's not going to have a great experience. You're not going to have a great experience and no one's going to be happy with the results.
That's great. Now I want to turn to managing the team or managing the person or the team and depending on the size of the business. What are some of the challenges that you see? And I don't know if now you do like HR business partner type of activity, but what are some of the things that you see? Because you talked about processes and automation, which is great. I want to, also that talk about maybe, managing the team and then how much delegation plays into it.
Yeah. So managing the team really to me is about whether we're working with our clients or internally. It's about managing expectations. So in that onboarding process, when they come on, before they're even hired, they have a clear job description, right? So most business owners don't know how to write a job description, right? It's not an expertise that they have. What is that person going to be doing? And then more importantly, what are they going to be judged on, right? You want to set the rules of the road so those employees know, if I do this, I'm going to have this result. If I do that, I'm going to have that result. So I want to stay within the guidelines of the job, right? Then with that, once that job description is written with what the rules are, that should become an automatic performance management document that's revisited minimum once a year. We recommend twice a year. So there's a 6-month review. Hey, here were the 5 things that we said you were going to be judged upon in your interview. How did you perform, right? And then build on that from there. So I think that, that sort of follow through, that sort of consistency, that sort of planning is what allows that employee to grow, right? So from a management standpoint, if I've now set the clear rules for the employees, right? They've accepted the challenges of those rules. They've accepted the job description that's clearly written. They've accepted at their interview process and then their onboarding process, they've accepted how they're going to be judged in their performance management at 6 and 9 years. They've accepted the challenge. Now, the odds of that person who's accepted those challenges because they're clearly defined of needing heavy oversight or heavy motivation, it's not as great as someone who is just, hey, I got a phone and a desk and some days I make phone calls and some days I respond to emails, right? So the delegation and the management becomes easier when the work is done up front and the definition and the guidelines are set and accepted to at the beginning of the game, which is the recruiting and onboarding process.
That's great. Now let's turn to retaining the team, retaining mm-hmm. the person. That's been a challenge, especially when you have big businesses and other competitors always trying to poach. What do you tell or how do you maybe help people in the various clientele that you help? How do you help them deal with this or employee retention challenges?
So it really goes back to the answer that I just gave about setting the rules for the employees. So secrets be told, most employees are not motivated by money, right? So yes, the big business can come in and say, hey, I'm going to give you a little bit more money. And of course, look, there's economic realities to everything, but just let's call it roughly even. Why most people leave is because they don't understand the rules of how their workforce, and that creates frustrations. Those frustrations, that misery, if you will, creates people that say, I want to move to a different business, right? Bigger businesses, remember back to the beginning of our conversation at big HR departments, they've built these things. So when you go to those businesses, what they're getting in many instances is that consistency, the rules of the road. So what I tell to most small business owners, what the stats are, 70% of most employees are in small businesses. The small businesses that have set the rules of the road do not necessarily have the same turnover problems. I'm going to subscribe that they have much, much lower turnover problems than those businesses that have, hey, there's a phone and a desk. You seem like a nice person. Thanks for coming, right? That business has a lot of turnover. This business that has process, procedure, all through every step of the way from recruiting to onboarding to training to performance management, those businesses don't have turnover problems. And those business owners very rarely say, I can't find any good people out there. when I hear someone say there's no good people out there or no one's loyal, it has nothing to do with the employee. It has everything to do with the business owner and how they've avoided process and procedure.
That's great. The final question is related to us. Now that you've recruited them, you've onboarded them, you've trained and performance managed them, and you've retained them, how do you scale the team?
Well, scaling the team, really, there's two sides of it. There's levels of automation, and then there's breaking down jobs. So we continually look to take any position and break down the, usually they have about 10 responsibilities in most jobs. So every year, what we look to do is to take each job and say, what 3 to 5 things can we push down to a new job? Let's call it a lower paid job, right? And then that creates a workforce track, right? So we always look for things to say, is this something a mid-level manager should be doing? Or is this something that if we took these 5 things from this mid-level manager and these 3 to 5 things from this level manager and create a new job around that, right? So take the automated or the more menial tasks, if you will, and continue to push that down to a lower cost employee. It does a couple of things, right? It clearly elevates the better people to be doing, or the higher level people to be doing what they're supposed to be doing. It creates that track. But the lower level people are easier to find, easier to onboard, easier to train. And then they can bubble up to the next level of position. So what we're always looking to do is to say, what position can we take the bottom level of work from and then bottom level from this? And does that make sense to combine that into a new position? And that's really what we're always looking to do, because let the top 3 to 5 things that person does are probably more important than the bottom 3 to 5 things. So let's have them focus on those top 3 things that lifts everyone up.
Yeah, the 80-20 rule.
Yep.
Okay, that's awesome. Well, thank you so much, Rick, for your time. Obviously, this is a very important topic, right? You know, it's all about people. You know, you got to get the people right, then you got to get the process, and you got to get the policies right. Any last minute, a couple of takeaways that you want our listeners to take away from this conversation?
Yeah, I would say the last thing that I would say, and this goes back to probably one of your first questions or in the beginning of our conversation, what motivates you? And I said laziness, right? And I think that the things that we've talked about, what prevents the business owner from doing these types of things, in many cases, is arrogance. And I don't mean that in a negative way, just in the sense that I know what I'm doing. It's just give it to me. I'll take care of it. It's easier for me to just do it than explain it to somebody. That's a level of arrogance that prevents that business owner from expanding their team, which will ultimately expand their business. So it's that wall that we have to jump over, and it's a hard wall to jump over. So when I always combine it, it's arrogance and laziness, which should be driving the entrepreneur.
That's great. Arrogance and laziness. Okay. I'll make a note of that. Well, thank you again, Rick. And how can people get a hold of you, find you, follow your work?
So the most simple way is, and we're out there on all the social media platforms. We have 3 or 4 team members that are doing that sort of stuff for us. But the most simple way is our website, which is turningpointhcm.com, turningpointhcm.com. Certainly my email is always accessible, which is Rick, R-I-C-K, at turningpointhcm.com. Or if you want to call me, love phone calls, 631-769-4131, 631-769-4131.
That's great. Thanks again for sharing that. And we're going to have that information as part of the show notes. So folks who may be driving, who may not be able to write it down, once you get a chance, you can look at the show notes and you'll have all of that information that Rick just shared as well. So thanks again. Till next week. Bye for now.